Hello all together, it's time for next talk. I hope you're all active still after a lot of information. My topic is managing distributed secrets in applications on Cloud Foundry with Spring Cloud Vault, quite a long name. You can find the presentation and all demos I'm giving today also on GitHub already, so just in case you want to look at the presentation afterwards. I brought a lot of slides, but I will skip some of these because this is a one-hour talk. In fact, I will more concentrate on giving some demos what is Vault about. To my person, I'm coming from Stuttgart, Germany, some consultancy company. We also support you in developing cloud-native applications, mainly in Java, using Cloud Foundry. I'm a frequent speaker at lots of conferences, like I was at the Spring I.O. this year in Barcelona. I'm also an OWASP member, so that's why I'm so keen on security. So there were a lot of talks talking about authentication, authorization with OpenID Connect, like the last talk here. So we are pretty good at that stuff, doing authentication well and authorization well for our APIs so far. But what about our sensitive data? So that's sometimes a weak point in our applications. Also seen by the OWASP, the Open Web Application Security Project organization. Just a short hands, who knows the OWASP top 10 already? Ah, a lot of people. So towards the end of the year, we can expect a new version of that. So in fact, they declined the release candidate 1 at the moment, so they're reworking it completely again towards the end of the year. But the 0.A6 sensitive data exposure is still in the current one. What makes it even more important to our applications is the new general data protection regulation coming in the European Union. I think it will be there in May next year, so everybody has to follow that. They mentioned their privacy by design for our applications and breach notifications for applications. So it is expected that our applications have privacy designed into the application already from the beginning, not putting it in the application at the end, as we do it sometimes currently. But our application should deal with sensitive data and protect the sensitive data of all people. And also have a clue if there is a breach, so that we can notify the people that are affected by that breach. So that becomes even more important. So what is typical sensitive data? You can think of passwords, service credentials like DB passwords, something like messaging credentials, even OAuth2 client secret stuff. For this we also need some kind of secret credentials. Then we have encryption keys of all kinds, credit card numbers, social security numbers. The list can be more and more. I think all people that develop with Spring Boot knows lots of these application property files, application YAML files. You probably also have seen database credentials in clear text into that application properties. That's what I see each day in the projects. Even I noticed some production passwords in such property files. So some developers have always to have it a comfortable way, so they sometimes use the same passwords for productive and development stages, which is very serious. We want to get rid of that. So that's a sample as we see it very often in the wild. So my super secret password. And even if you secure your passwords with some encryption, you have the chicken egg problem again. Because what to do with the key you need for encrypting that stuff? So you need to encrypt the key again for that first encryption, and then it goes on and on. So several problems we have to deal each time in our projects. So today I want to talk a bit about some security evolution there. It starts by using Spring Boot, as I mentioned here, with the application properties. Then you have the Spring Cloud project. It gets a bit better with Spring Cloud Config Server already, because that supports encryption as a service out of the box. But even there, you have the problem still with where to store the encryption key. So either you have the private-public asymmetric stuff, or you have the symmetric key to store. Next step would be to bring together Spring Cloud with the Vault project. I will give a short introduction to Vault. And the final stage is to bring the Spring Cloud Vault together and put it also into the Cloud Foundry cloud. So what is Vault? Vault is implemented by a company, HashiCorp. I think you all know Vagrant, for example, or Consul of that company. So they also built Vault. It's open source. You can have it as open source, but you can also have it as an enterprise edition with some more features and support for that. Especially if you have to roll it out into your big enterprise company with high availability features and stuff like that, you may go to the enterprise edition as well. So Vault is a tool for all kinds of secrets to manage. So Vault can deal with tokens, can deal with passwords, can even create SSL certificates for your local CA. Automatically can deal with API keys, DB credentials, and lots of other secrets you can imagine. So the Vault lead at HashiCorp names it as a security Swiss Army knife, so that's even more suitable here in Switzerland now. So most people think of Vault as a simple key value security store, but it's much more than just that. So you have the key features, the secure secret storage, as I mentioned. You have the ability to create dynamic secrets. That's very important for database credential rotating, for example. So it does some similar things as the mentioned GredHub tool we have in Cloud Foundry. You also have the data encryption inside that vault that uses a secure AES cipher. And you also have automatically leasing, renewal, and revocation features. So all your secrets have some lease time. You can configure so they are all are automatically invalidated at some stage. You have also some supporting features like authentication for Vault, so you can authenticate via several providers for that. You have a fine-grade authorization, so not everybody can access all the secrets in Vault. So you have a really fine-grained ACL feature, so that every administrator, for example, can only see some part of the Vault storage. So if you have an insider attack, for example, that insider can only attack some small piece of Vault, not the complete storage. It also has audit logs, so if somebody wants to attack, it's all in the log. So the other admin recognized that at a sudden that somebody else wanted to attack something, so they can just shut down the Vault to get knowledge of that person that wants to attack that before something serious happens. And you also have the high availability mode for that stuff. So the main architecture of Vault is some small executable. You just have to download an executable and can just run it out of the box. If you want higher availability, for example, then you can run it with Consul. Then you have some authentication features that you can use. You have some different storage backends, some different types where you store your secret data. And you have some secret backends, so some mechanism what secrets you can store. And you have that audit backend for that logging stuff. And Vault incorporates some trust boundaries, so it does not trust the client, and it also does not trust our storage backends. So if you store it into some, for example, MySQL, so that's an untrusted data sync for Vault. So Vault never gives the encryption keys or stuff like that to the backend database. Regarding the Vault storage, we have lots of possibilities. You can store it in MySQL, in Google Cloud, platform services, Amazon Web Service, Postgres. You even have some plugin mechanism, which is quite new to Vault. So you can even store it to proprietary stuff, more proprietary stuff like Oracle databases. And there's more to come. But you can also store it for testing purposes, which I'm demonstrating right now using the file system or in memory. So you also have possibilities for different kind of secrets. So you can generate PKA certificates out of the box for local CI stuff. You have a transit backend for providing encryption as a service, a key value store for just storing key value secrets. You can also generate your keys for SSH terminals automatically. Yeah, you can also then generate credentials automatically for MongoDB with rotation, for example. So there's lots of possibilities there as well. And for authentication, you also have several possibilities. You can just use simple username password stuff, use a token. You can use LDAP. Multi-factor authentication is possible. Also Google Cloud Platform or Amazon API key. But even you can use mutual TLS and also Kubernetes, or you can use GitHub accounts for authentication. So one more security thing Vault implements is that not one administrator can open Vault initially. So if you start up Vault, it is initially sealed. So you have to unseal Vault first, and there we have the concept of key shares. So you always need several keys to unlock Vault. So no admin should have all the keys. So at least you should need one or two or three administrators so that you can initially open the Vault for operation. So that's another security, like for example, if you wanted to launch a bad example is an atom bomb, then you also need several persons to initiate that launch. That's kind of same approach here. So it's demo time. I want to show some small. So as I've mentioned, Vault is just a simple executable. You can download it from Vault project. So if you want to start Vault, it's quite simple. So there's also a development mode, which I'm already also using for the demo today. It's a bit shorter. You don't have to do all that key share unsealing for that. So that's a bit simpler mode for that. So you just start Vault with the dev command. Then you have Vault in place. So what Vault gives you is that's my mouse. So in the development mode, it just generates one unsealed key, and it's automatically unsealed already. And you get a root token for authentication. So that root token will be important for us to authenticate, actually, to Vault. Then you have to give information to the Vault client mode where the Vault server has been started. And then you can just operate with Vault, so just get a status of the Vault. So it's not sealed. We have one key share, for example. And now you have to authenticate to Vault. So in fact, that token authentication is also only suitable for demo purposes. So for serious production, you should use AWS API or LDAP or something more serious. What I want to do now is create a bit simpler token that I can remember. I give it just a name, so that's also a token I can authenticate because I pre-configured my demo applications that I have for that token, so that's a bit simpler. So now Vault is operational. You can also look what is inside Vault already. So Vault works with some mounts of backends, as I mentioned. So we have two backends now. We have the copyhole and the secret backends. The system backend is just for internal stuff of Vault. So the secret is the key value store you have. The secret key value store operates with that authorization stuff, with ACL. So depending on the user, you cannot access all trees of the Vault. And the copyhole is much more simpler. So the copyhole is just bound to the token you are authenticating. So there's no ACL with that. You can just store some token. Everybody who has that token can read that token again. So just mounting another backend is quite easy. So for example, for encryption as a service, you need that transit backend. You just mount it, and then you have a new path for just accessing also that encryption as a service, which my next demo application will be using. So now with that in place, we are already to go for the next step. Just closed my. The next step would be to use it actually with Spring. So there are, in fact, two projects of Spring. So you can use it without the cloud config server, actually with just using the Spring Vault project. Or you can use it with the cloud config server. So the initial demo will show how it is used with Spring Vault. Spring Vault just provides you a Vault template. So those that are familiar already with Spring know the GDBC template, the OAuth2 template, stuff like that. Now you have a new template called Vault template, so you can do most of the operations with the Vault template against the Vault. And you also have abstract Vault configuration that configures the connection to the Vault for you in Spring. So we have also some demo for that. So for that demo, I used that encryption as a service stuff of Vault. As you can see here, this is the encrypt sensible data. It's just encrypting two attributes of that person, like a credit card number and a social security number. Using Vault, so you get that Vault operations from the Vault template, and then you can just call the op for transit. You have to use a key name, which I'm creating on starting the application automatically. Then you encrypt it without actually knowing the key. So it's just a symbolic name to reference the key of Vault inside. Then the other part is to decrypt again that stuff. And I'm just calling it in the corresponding operations, like, for example, the find all method. I just decrypt on the fly all the sensible data to show it to the user in the UI. And also in saving, I'm encrypting that stuff. So, and starting. So live demos are always a bit dangerous, as we learned in the keynote. So, no. So I just call a REST API that I have put above that service, just decrypting the numbers. As you can see, it's automatically decrypted again. I also have some other API that use the encrypted version of that stuff. As you can see, now you see the encrypted values as you directly get from the database. So Vault puts in some namespace in front of that to know with which version of the API Vault encrypted that, so it knows which version to decrypt it again. Also, I'm using some in-memory database for that stuff, so you can also see that it's really encrypted there. As you can see, we have the credit card number encrypted and also the social security number encrypted, and I just decrypted it on the fly using the Vault, the Spring Cloud, Spring Vault project. So that's the first stage to use encryption as a service in your application. So there's no you can use it very easily, so you can encrypt all that sensitive data you have in your applications. And I think most of our applications nowadays have some sensitive data that are due to data privacy stuff. So that was the encryption as a service. You can also use Spring Cloud Config. There are two types you can use it. You can use Spring Cloud Config directly. So if you use Spring Cloud Config directly, Spring Cloud Vault directly, as I name it, then you directly have some kind of config server that points to a Vault server, and you can just encrypt all your properties out of the box with Vault. And all your application properties are automatically mapped into that secret key value store for you. So it's mapped automatically in your application namespace. So if you call your application, for example, application 1, then it's stored into secret/application1 namespace automatically for you. So you can also rotate your database credential with Vault that way. So you just have to give that Vault configuration the name of your Spring data source property, which is that pre-configured one of Spring Boot. And then it automatically puts in the decrypted value when running the application. So it's something similar to a GitHub we've heard. And there's a second approach to use Vault with Spring Config Server. With that, you have the possibility to still use your not sensitive data in a Git repository, but additionally use your sensitive data to be put in the Vault. So you can choose which property goes into Vault, which property goes into the Git repository. What you have to configure for that is just activate a second profile, Spring profile, just to the existing Git one, which is the default so far. You just have to activate the Vault profile in addition, and then you get also support for Vault. Then you have to configure the addresses for the Vault server, and you're good to go. Now that's the next one. I also have some small demo for that. First, I have to stop the old one here. So I have a Spring Cloud Config server and a Spring Cloud Config client prepared for that. Hopefully that works as well. So now I should have. So I also have some small REST client for displaying my properties. So at the moment, I only have that not sensitive property stored in my Git repository. So that Git repository is shown here. On GitHub, I have just a small Git repositories with just that property inside that is read by the config server and returned to my client. The second one is not returned so far because I did not have stored it in Vault already, so it's not inside Vault. But we can change that quite quickly if we just write that into that namespace in Vault of my application, which is called config client in that case. How was it named? MySecret. I can just name it test, for example. So if I refresh, it's not displayed so far. If you use the Spring Cloud Config Server, you know that you can have an automatic refresh if you post to some special address. I just post to that localhost 8080 refresh endpoint, and then it should automatically be refreshed without restarting the server. No? I named it wrong. Ah, that's always the thing with the... Should always write it the correct way, then it should work. So we have to refresh again. I think it's late today. Oh, finally, I got it right. So as you can see, it now decrypted automatically from the Vault in Spring Cloud Config Server. So you can have both worlds into one. You can have the non-sensitive data in the Git repositories and store the sensitive data in Vault by using the same Spring Cloud Config Server. The last slide I wanted to show was that you can also have it inside Cloud Foundry with the Vault stuff. There's a Vault service broker, official one, by HashiCorp you can use, and there's also a new project, Spring Cloud Vault Connector, that does that auto-configuration with Spring Boot stuff. I did not bring a demo because that's just in milestone status, and I have expected it to be finished this week, but the Spring guys were a bit late this week, so Spring Boot has some delay. So it came out just today, I think. And also that Spring Vault stuff was a bit delayed, so unfortunately, I could not show a real demo of that stuff. So we are at the end of the session. Some question?
For the Spring Cloud Config Server or for your own application that wants to use a Vault template, in a real-world scenario, would you have to give some token so that the Vault server knows which ACL to apply?
Yes, you have to give a token to authenticate your application to Vault.
And where is this token then stored?
That token is stored in the Bootstrap. Yeah, but as I mentioned before, just giving a token is a bad example for doing it in production. There are several other ways to authenticate with vaults. There's a pretty good documentation that documents all that, lots of authentication possibilities. You have mutual TLS, you have AWS possibilities to authenticate. So there's no need to put a clear text token inside your property.
With Spring 5 and Webflux on the doorstep, so encryption and decryption and transition is a blocking operation. Is there also plans to have a reactive driver for the vault?
I think so, because Spring Security also is just in the way implementing reactive support for all that security stuff. So I think, according to that, also Spring Vault will have some in place. They're also developing currently the Spring Vault 2 versions, which are in Milestone 3, so it's quite early stage, so I cannot say how far they are with reactive stuff.
Thanks.
Oh, the last row.
So I have used Spring Cloud Config Server a lot recently. And a lot of the encryption and decryption of the properties can be done out of the box using Spring Cloud Config Server itself. If you have asymmetric or symmetric encryption, you can do that with the Config Server itself. And it can do properties encryption and decryption on the fly. So I'm just failing to bit understand where should I use Vault in this case. Because if you know, there are encrypt and decrypt URIs available out of the box from Config Server.
Yes,
if you provide the asymmetric and symmetric keys within the server, you could make sure if the encryption or decryption would be handled by the server or by the client itself. So I just want to know, why should I go for Vault, and in which particular case then I would have to go?
Because
right now the Config Server solves most of the problems.
Yeah, that's a good question. The main advantage of using Vault with Spring Cloud Config is that you, with Spring Cloud Config, you have also to administer your keys for encryption, decryption. So then you have the next problem with chicken egg problem, you have to put the key somewhere in clear text. You also have to encrypt that key again.
Yeah, right now it's
the advantage of Vault is that it never exports some kind of key, so you never get hand on the encryption key. And you have the possibility to authenticate with several methods, and you also have the possibility to have an audit log and have ACL. All that you don't have with the Spring Config Server out of the box. So you have more control. So it's a bit more secure than Spring Cloud Config Server. So if you want to mostly 100% secure, then you have to use hardware modules for security, but they are quite expensive sometimes.
Thank you.
So I think one last question, then we think we'll run out of time.
You were talking about this in the context of GDPR. But there's more to GDPR than just protecting data. There's also storing the consent and the permission to do with a piece of data, which also has to be stored in a protected way. Are you doing any complete GDPR solutions, or are you just handling encryption with this storing?
I'm not sure if I got your question right.
Well, there's more to GDPR than just encrypting the data.
Yeah, you're right. It's correct. It's just only a small part that I just refer to here.
And I wondered, and other bits of it will probably involve encryption, like storing the consent that given for the use of data, and storing the purpose.
Yes. So the first step is to not store them at all. So that's the best approach, so to store the least amount of data that is required. But that small amount of data that is required should be stored as secure as possible.
Yes, encrypted.
Yeah.
But so I wondered whether you were doing a higher level GDPR solution in addition to just covering the encryption side of it.
Yeah, there's lots of organizational stuff in addition to the technical stuff so far, but that rules in that protection regulation is also, as always, very unclear formulated, as I name it. So privacy by design can be anything.
Yeah.
Okay, so if there are any further questions, I'm around until the end of the day, so thank you.